The fact that the work of art is not the thing, it's really the experience that the viewer has with the work. That's the art. It's an exchange. So then it was a simple step from there to begin to make performance work so that the work is actually being created sort of in a contract with the audience. You're creating an image live, and the audience has to sort of meet you halfway with that.
Meet me halfway. Right at the borderline is where I'm going away. For you, I'll be looking out. Night and day, took my heart to the limit, and this is where I stay. I can't go any further than this. I want you so bad, my only wish.
When I was 3, I contracted tuberculosis, and at that time the cure was that you just were supposed to have bed rest. And so I went to live with my grandmother, and there was a whole year when I wasn't supposed to get out of bed for much of anything. So my grandmother and I just drew. We drew pictures and made stories, and that just kind of saved me. Otherwise I think I would have been like totally schizophrenic, you know. I would say that my encounter with feminist art was an accident. I think my mother was really very sort of ahead of her time. She was studying at Mills College, and she wrote a paper about the fallacies of the average intelligence test and how it was class-based and it wasn't fair. And so they kicked her out of Mills for that. She was a model in Paris, and briefly, and she was working for the designer Jacques Patou, and she got fired for looking at the new creations. She didn't really want to, you know, have be confined by the roles that women were confined to, and that was very hard for her, I think. You know, when I was in school, actually, I encountered prejudices myself. And one of the worst was that I was in a painting class, and I was really quiet. When I was a student, I went to school at UCLA, I started, and then I went to Irvine. When I was 18, I was married, and I had a child. And my mother died, like in, you know, not quite in that order, but, and I was kind of really on my own when I separated from my husband. So for the most part of my education, I was a single mother, you know, just kind of spinning in outer space, trying to make things work, because I didn't want to wind up working at Taco Bell for the rest of my life, which I had done briefly. So I was pretty quiet. I was a little different from people my age because I had this child, you know. And but I was making, I understood what I was doing. And I was making these weird paintings based on the assignments I was given. And the person teaching the class came in and, you know, chuckled at one of my paintings. And he brought other people in to see the painting. There were several times that other people came in to look at what I was doing. And so at the end of the semester, the quarter, I got my grades. And I had gotten a C in painting. And I worked up all my nerve, and I went to the teacher, and I said, I don't understand this. I said, I did all the work, and I thought that my paintings were good. You even brought people in to look at them. He said, yes, we do think that the paintings were good. But we don't think you know why they were good. There was another list that came out that was about the 100 most important people in the art world. And I think there were only 2 women artists, I think, Cindy Sherman and Louise Bourgeois. There were some dealers who are women, maybe some museum or gallery people, but the majority of the whole list was men. And I think what we've seen now, lately, say in the last 10, 20 years, is the resurgence of the market controlling everything. Okay, so what is considered the best has to do with what the most important collectors are buying. And they seem to, you know, follow certain artists like their sheep. I mean, Jeff Koons is number one, and I don't think that the work is all that profound or interesting, personally. I think that because everything's driven by money right now, work that deals with less pleasant subjects, or that is less escapist, is less likely to be collected, to be exhibited. And I think that a lot of work by women falls into that area. You know, that women, many women artists are making work about their lives. Not all, but many. And I think that the problems just have continued. I think that things are cyclical. And I think that there was quite a bit of success, and I would say since the 80s, things have been going down some because there's been more of an emphasis on market-driven value of art rather than art valued for its content. And I think that in general, the atmosphere in some ways is much more conservative right now. But with the change in the market, perhaps, you know, perhaps there will be more artist-run organizations and there will be some kind of a change also in what's being put out there. Well, in a lot of ways, I feel like, you know, everything is marketing. And, you know, it's almost impossible to escape. I mean, we're constantly being told we have to buy things, you know, we have to consume. And in fact, this piece that you see here on the card, and I can show you a little document of the project that I did with this piece in store windows, because I organized this event called The Long Weekend, and it was all the windows of an abandoned furniture store with either video projections, performances, or installations by different artists around, loosely around the theme of commodification and consumer.